she came up, she was holding in her arms the Savior of the world. His work. And so when you and I look at John 15, and Jesus said, if a man abide in me, and my words abide in him. So you and I, if we're going to live this life that Jesus is talking about in the book of John, then not only is it going to be Christ-centered, it's going to be Bible-anchored. And number three, it's going to be prayer-supported. Now look what he said. He said, if you abide in me and I abide in you, you shall do what? You shall ask what you will. And then in John 16, he supports that again. In John 15, 16, he supports that again. So what it is prayer supported. When you and I again look at the last few hours of the life of our Lord Jesus Christ, what did he do? He went into the Garden of Gethsemane. You read this in Matthew 26, Luke 22, Mark 14, John 18. He went into the Garden of Gethsemane. And the Bible says that he was very sorrowful. What did he do? He prayed. He prayed. He came back and had gone to sleep. He goes back again and a second time. What did he do? Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be. Three times he went into the Garden of Gethsemane. Three times he fell, once on his face, while the Bible said on his knees and fell down to the ground. Three times he prayed. What did he do? He prayed. Jesus Christ was up all night in prayer before he selected his apostles. Jesus Christ said, can you not watch with me? Watch therefore and pray that you be not led into temptation. What do we need to do? We need to watch and do what? We need to pray. That's what Paul said in 1 Thessalonians 5, 17. Pray without ceasing. Paul said in Romans, continuing instant in prayer. That's what James said in James 5, in which he said, the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. The Bible tells us in Acts 2 and verse 42, they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine, in the fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in what? In prayer. Do we pray? Oh, Lord, bless me, my wife, my son, John, his wife, that's Lord always. Do we pray? The Bible says in James, the Bible tells us that Elijah was a man of life passion. He had passion in his prayer. If you want to read two great prayers, go to 1 Kings chapter number 18. You remember when he confronted the 450 priests of Baal. Prayers do not have to be long to be effective. I thought about the brother B.J. Clark. I love this. Brother B.J. Clark was holding a meeting somewhere. And the brother who was leading the prayer prayed, Lord, help. And he forgot Brother Clark's name, what he was going to say, help him to have a ready recollection. And I'm grateful to the men who pray for us, aren't we, Brother Riley, that we'll have a ready recollection of the thing we're going to say. But at any rate, he was praying, and he wanted to pray that God would give Brother Clark, but he couldn't remember his name. And so he just said, Lord, I pray that he'll have a better recollection than I've got right now. You'll remember the word about you. Prayers don't have to be long. They don't have to be loud. Oh, thou holy and mighty God. Which the Bible recognizes this. I know that. Don't misunderstand. I'm not denigrating the fact that in our praise of this high and holy God. But you know what? Elijah said, God, I'm doing this, you're me. You can read that prayer in 30 seconds. Fire came down from heaven, consumed the sacrifice, the wood, the stone, lapped up the water. I believe Elijah prayed a little bit longer and more in the latter part of that chapter. He was persistent in his prayer. I believe the position, you know, you look at that and you see again, he went up on Mount Carmel in the place that he prayed. his persistence in it. Praying. Send a servant out there, and the servant comes back and says, I don't see anything. He kept praying, the servant comes back, telling him, I don't see anything. Keeps praying, comes back. After 7 times, the servant came back and said, oh, yeah, there's a hand out there. It's going to rain. He told him, well, yeah, you better get ready, man. It's going to rain. And so when you and I look at the life that's found in Christ, if you and I look at Jesus Christ, who is the center of our life, when we look and have this distinguished life, that it's Christ-centered, that it is Bible-anchored, that it is prayer-supported, and that it is fruit-bearing. Now notice, go back with me to John chapter 15, in which he said, every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. You know what that fruit is? That's another Christian. He said, I am the true vine, my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. Every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now you can go down in John chapter number 15, and you'll find again that he used that word fruit. The fruit is, that we as children of God are to bear fruit. You know what? Not many Christians do that. Not many Christians bear fruit. Not many Christians bring up. Now I realize that not every child of God is going to be, a personal evangelist to the extent they're going to baptize 100 people every year. But listen, you and I must be instrumental in bringing others to the cause of Jesus Christ, one at a time. Oh, we like big things. We like them at Lithia Spring. I'm sure you do. Brother Ben McKnight taught how to do personal evangelism. And he would go, he went throughout the United States and he'd do these seminars on personal evangelism. I mean, he'd get you fired up if you listened to him. I remember the first time I heard this lesson number one, that tape. This was back in the 60s. I gave a fellow $10. I said, I'll give you $10 of that tape. Man, I got hundreds of thousands of dollars of worth of value out of that tape. I wore it out. But I remember something he said. He was holding a meeting. And he went home with a preacher every night at church, and he said, we'd sit down at the table, and he called it, do up a cup of coffee. And he said, we'd do up a cup of coffee. And so while the preacher was getting the coffee ready, he said, I looked at the cap on that coffee, and it was Sanka. Then, you know, Sanka had just come out. Man, it was very popular. And he said, you know what, brother? He said, this reminds me of my brethren. And the brother said, well, what's that? And he said, well, it says on the top of this lid, 98% of the active ingredients have been removed. That's the way it is with some Christians. Fruit bearing. Herein. Now listen to this. If you abide in me, my words abide in you. You shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. That's the prayer. Herein is my Father glorified. God is glorified when you bear much fruit. So shall you be my disciples. John 15. In order for us to be the kind of Christian, to live that distinguished Christian life, it must be Christ-centered, Bible-anchored, prayer-supported, fruit-bearing. Thank you, God bless you.
Thank you, Brother Ego. We appreciate that question. We're talking about Brother Ramsey. Several Brother Ramsey passed away. He was in a coma, basically, for the last 24 hours, laid in bed, preaching sermons, one after the other. Great speaker. If you ever get to listen to one of his tapes, I recommend it. Great listen. We'll take about